All right. Hello, everyone. It's a real pleasure and honor for me to be able to introduce Dr. Park, our speaker today. So Dr. Park is Director of Cerebrovascular and Endovascular Neurosurgery and Associate Residency Program Director of Neurosurgery at the University of Virginia. He's an Indiana native, which is in the Midwest for those of you who are from California and don't know any of the flyover states. He earned a doctorate in medicine from Indiana University School of Medicine in 2002 and completed a general surgery internship and neurosurgical surgery residency at the University of California, San Diego Medical Center. From 2009 to 2013, Dr. Park served as Lieutenant Commander and Staff Neurosurgeon at Naval Medical Center San Diego, and was subsequently deployed to Kandahar, Afghanistan, in support of Operation Enduring Freedom, where he was the sole neurosurgeon for the southern half of the combat theater and performed over 150 life-saving operations over the course of 6 months. He's been awarded the Navy and Marine Corps Combination Medals, Navy Unit Combination, Afghanistan Campaign Medal, and NATO Medal, among others. He subsequently completed an endovascular neurosurgery fellowship at the Barrow Neurological Institute in Phoenix, and then joined the neurosurgery faculty at the University of Utah, where he was director and founder of the endovascular neurosurgery fellowship and associate residency program director of neurosurgery, during which time myself and Dr. Sivakumar both had the pleasure of training under him. He was subsequently recruited to the Department of Neurosurgery at UVA. He is recognized as a thought leader in endovascular neurosurgery and neurointerventional surgery, with over 150 peer-reviewed publications and several book chapters. Dr. Park helped lead UVA Health to its highest designation as a center of excellence for its care of cerebral cavernous malformations. Being recognized as a center of excellence took a lot of hard work and collaboration, but Dr. Park was integral to that process. Today, he is going to talk to us about dural arteriovenous fistulas, the good, the bad, and the ugly. And again, it's a real pleasure. Dr. Park's not only, one of my mentors, but a good friend, has a beautiful family, and, is one of the people who really abused us, the minimal possible during residency. So without further ado, I'm going to hand the floor over to Dr. Park, and thank you so much for joining us today.
All right. Well, thank you very much, Jian and Wally, for inviting me. It's a true privilege to talk with all of you in Southern California. Having spent 11 years out there, I truly understand how wonderful it is. And unfortunately, I wasn't good enough to be recruited to stay, in LA or San Diego. So I just kept moving further and further east. There's not much further east I can get from Charlottesville, Virginia. And this is a picture of our campus. It's basically the house that Thomas Jefferson built. So no disclosures relevant to this talk. I am on the clinical events committee for one of Medtronic's endovascular trials. I was looking through all my photo albums to see what pictures I had of Wally and Jian, and not surprisingly, there's lots of pictures of Wally, but Jian normally kept a very low profile. Wally, on the other hand, not so much. I did find this, and when I asked one of his former co-residents if they had any to share, they provided this for me, and I'm not sure this will play, but clearly Jian is taking full advantage of the karaoke scene down in Southern California. I did, as Jian said, I left Utah, where my passion is skiing, Snowbird, Utah, and when we moved out east here, we have a little ski area called Snowshoe, West Virginia, and if that scale isn't really, if you can't tell the scale, the differences between the two, this is the front side of Snowbird. It's a massive mountain, and for scale, this is where Snowshoe would fit in. I think there's about 10 times the acreage of Snowshoe to Snowbird. But as far as dural arteriovenous fistulas, we'll kind of go through the introduction, some of the treatment strategies, and a couple of unique types of treatment cases that we've done, as well as some illustrative cases. And since this is a multidisciplinary audience, I think hopefully we have enough interesting information for everybody. So as a background, dural arteriovenous fistulas, they're abnormal connections that develop between the arteries and the veins And generally, they involve the venous sinuses around the periphery of the brain. They are thought to develop as a thrombosinus for one reason or another, attempts to recanalize. And they're oftentimes associated with a prior history of dural venous sinus thrombosis, some type of trauma, and it could be very remote, like a car accident in which a head injury was sustained years ago, and also iatrogenic following any type of, any number of surgeries that involve the transverse or any of the venous sinuses. And that little illustration, which was taken from the cerebral dural AV fistulas book, by Dr. Gross and colleagues. It kind of shows you where the arteries run in the dura, and as they go through the dura into the veins, the anastomosis that they form, those are all pathologic. And it's a true fistula in the sense that that blood is not doing anything useful. And it's just going from the arterial side directly to the venous side without the intervening capillary bed. The most common locations are the transverse sigmoid sinus junction right behind the ear. But they can occur anywhere along where the venous sinuses are, including the petrosal sinuses or the superior sagittal sinus. But you can also find spinal dural arteriovenous fistulas as well, but this talk will be mostly centered on the cranial variety. So the arterial supply is usually from the external carotid artery branches. The middle meningeal is one of the most is the artery that is most often involved, especially with those along the transverse and sigmoid sinus. But they also come up from the transmastoid branches of the occipital artery. They can come from the posterior auricular artery or the ascending pharyngeal arteries, and oftentimes it's a combination of these. They can arise from meningeal branches coming off the vertebral, as well as the internal carotid artery, like the artery of Bernasconi-Casinari. A lot of times we'll venture posteriorly through the tentorium and anastomose with the fistula site. So they can present in any number of ways. If they are asymptomatic, the patients either will have a vague complaint of headaches, which is one of the most common reasons why people are getting imaging, and there could be findings to those on non-invasive imaging studies. Pulsatile tinnitus, there are a lot of potential causes for that, including IIH, idiopathic intracranial hypertension, or other number of vascular causes. Most of those are not really dangerous or life-threatening, although dural arteriovenous fistulas can be. And there can be an audible bruit when you auscultate either behind the ear or near the external auditory canal with the stethoscope, especially those larger ones around that transverse sigmoid junction. Rarely, they can result in compressive neuropathies. These venous varices that form, that they can grow to be quite large. And over time, they can cause any number of cranial neuropathies. And in the worst case situation, they can present with intracranial hemorrhage. Oftentimes, that is related to the anatomy and the drainage patterns, as we'll talk about in a little bit. So with people that are presenting initially with headaches who are otherwise asymptomatic, you can find them on non-invasive studies. They're not the most robust sometimes, and they can even be silent on the MRI scans or CT scans. But occasionally, you can find evidence of them on these non-invasive studies, such as on this MRI brain, where you just see a little bit of a tangle of vessels down in the left occipital region. As I said, they can also be negative. And really, the gold standard workup for that is a diagnostic cerebral angiogram. You can not only identify the fistula, but you can also make out the angiomorphology of it and all of the venous or arterial supply, and also the venous supply of the fistula, as well as how it may have impacted the normal venous drainage from the brain, because all that is very important in how you manage these lesions. So In 1995, there were actually two publications which came out in terms of classifying dural arteriovenous fistulas. This is from Dr. Connard and out of France. And they came up with the classification system, and it really looks at where the arterial supply comes from, as well as the venous drainage. And you know, this is their illustrated sketch from the original article. And it kind of describes exactly, again, the different types of dural arteriovenous fistulas that you'll find most commonly around the transverse sigmoid sinus, and that's where these illustrations are from. But if you look at it just by definition, it really is, again, looking at the flow, the location, and then the venous drainage. So in type one, the fistula is confined to the sinus, and there's anterograde flow through the sinus. So it's basically going back down into the jugular veins, and there's not any backup of the drainage through the brain, which we term cortical venous drainage. So everything still drains normally. The blood that's being supplied to the brain from either the internal carotid arteries or the vertebral arteries are able to exit the brain in the usual fashion. Type 2A is also confined to the sinus for the location of the fistula, but there is retrograde flow through the sinus, which means if it's a left transverse sigmoid sinus dural arteriovenous fistula, it might actually drain out the right transverse sinus. But again, you do not see evidence of venous drainage of the fistula through the cortical veins. Now you start to get into more serious categories with the type 2B, where you are getting reflux into the cortical veins, and type 2A and B. And as you progress on the Connard classification, it's basically just getting more and more involved. And all of these from 2B on, they involve cortical venous reflux. Similarly, in 1995, that same year, Jonathan Borden came up with the Borden classification system, which is a term we use now. And again, it's looking at the same type of angiomorphology and venous drainage. And if you actually go back and look at that original article, these are figures taken from that article in the Journal of Neurosurgery. And these illustrations are by Dr. Borden himself, and is really very beautiful illustrations. And it was kind of surprising to see. We learn about the dural arteriovenous fistulas, we learn about the Connard and Borden classifications during training. But again, some of these landmark papers, you never really go back to look. And just recently, when I was doing some other type of research, I had a cause to pull the original landmark paper, and I was absolutely floored by these illustrations. I think it's just incredible what Dr. Borden published at that time. His system's a little bit easier, actually. Type 1 is just a drainage into the dural venous sinus, so it's basically a Connard 1 and 2A. And a Borden type 2 is Connard 2B and 2A and B, where you do get retrograde cortical venous drainage. And type 3 is equivalent to the Connard 3 and 5 scales. So in reality, it's actually even simpler than that. You have basically based on the either the Connard or the Borden classification, largely there's two groups. There's those that have a benign course and those which have an aggressive course. And the Connards 1 and 2A and the Borden 1s, those are the dural arteriovenous fistulas with the benign course. And then the Connard 2B, 2A and B, and on the way up to Connard 5, as well as the Borden 2s and 3s, those have an aggressive course. And you can see there is an annual risk of hemorrhage, which is not insignificant with those higher grade dural arteriovenous fistulas, with a pretty significant combined mortality rate of 10%. So anytime we see, basically you're looking for cortical venous reflux, anytime you see that, you know that this is a rather urgent situation, and the patient definitely should be counseled about this, as well as discussing potential management options for them. So for low-risk dural arteriovenous fistulas, again, in my practice, a lot of these are identified through pulsatile tinnitus. I have a healthy referral base from our otolaryngologists, both here at the university and around the community. And, you know, that's a very common complaint that ENT doctors will see. You know, we're just as an aside, when I see these patients, we always discuss what the potential etiologies for the pulsatile tinnitus is. And really the thing that we're looking for is to rule out whether or not they have a dural arteriovenous fistula. And, you know, that because that is the most important and pretty much the only dangerous pathology with that that initial presentation. For those low-risk dural arteriovenous fistulas, when we identify them, we have a discussion with the patient. And really my recommendation to them is, as long as it's not bothering you, as long as you're able to deal with it and it doesn't interfere with your quality of life, with how well you're doing at work or at school or interrupting your sleep, probably the best option is just to keep an eye on it. And, you know, if you do notice some significant change in the future, then it might require, it might warrant additional workup. But if it is low risk, the good news is dural arteriovenous fistulas tend to stay low risk. There are reports of manual compression therapy. You know, it's more of a historical treatment, and I will talk with patients about it, but I've yet to see anyone actually follow through. But they are reported to have some type of efficacy rate, 20 to 30% in the literature. And it's really if you have a left-sided dural AV fistula to the transverse sigmoid sinus junction, and you're looking to treat that conservatively without any interventions, what you can do is take your, if it's on the left, you take your contralateral hand, your right side, and then you intermittently occlude your carotid artery. You know, we tell them, well, just count to, you know, just put some pressure on where you feel your pulse in your neck, hold that there for maybe, you know, 20 to 30 seconds, the extent of a commercial, and then let it off and do that like when you're watching television, you know, once every television commercial cycle. The important thing is to tell them to use the contralateral hand, because in case they, you know, end up having some type of occlusive disease and they have stroke-like symptoms, as long as they're using a contralateral hand, their hand will fall down and they will stop occluding the vessel. High-risk dural arteriovenous fistulas, these are cases which pretty much need treatment. And there are any number of means. Endovascular treatment is a first-line treatment. Are able to either go transarterial or transvenous. And an important thing is getting to the fistula site and occluding that fistula site. If you only occlude proximally and you don't actually get to where it is, then these things will recur. And then it just becomes progressively harder with each step. Occasionally, if there's a failure of endovascular treatment and you burnt through all options to approach it with a catheter, you can do surgery for exploration and skeletonization of the sinus and ligation of the fistula. There's certain fistulas which are preferentially treated surgically, which we'll discuss in one of our cases. In radiosurgery, more and more information is coming out that these can be these can be effective for dural arteriovenous fistulas. That being said, there is a latency period of a couple of years before there is any effect, and the risk of spontaneous intracranial hemorrhage for high-risk dural AV fistulas is not insignificant. So that is something to consider given the known latency period for radiosurgery to work. This is basically my dural AV fistula management. If you've made the decision that you're going to go ahead with treatment, then for whatever reason, either it's high risk or occasionally you run across patients who have low risk dural AV fistulas, but the pulsatile tinnitus is just absolutely driving them crazy. And in which case then treatment is warranted. Hopefully you're able to have a embolization cure, either through a transarterial, transvenous, or combined. And if you don't have a cure, then obviously you have an option for surgery as well as radiosurgery. So looking at some cases, the good, the bad, and the ugly, as an old spaghetti western, Clint Eastwood in 1966. I'm a little bit younger than that, but not that much. And I watched this show on television when I was a child, and I absolutely loved it. This was a middle-aged woman. She presented with headaches and presented to an outside hospital. These are one of the ones, the cases that are particularly gratifying. And when she had her workup with a CT scan followed by an MRI scan, they initially diagnosed her with multiple intracranial aneurysms off the middle cerebral artery. And you can see the MRI scan and the T2, those flow voids, they're right around the middle cerebral artery territory. And so you can see why they thought that might be the case. But if you look at the CT angiogram on this reconstruction, it looks a little bit different. That's clearly not in arterial territory per se. When we saw the patient and did the workup after we looked at the CTA, we said, well, we don't think this is an aneurysm. This might be something else. And it might be that vein that you saw going along the anterior cranial fossa floor, that looks pretty suspicious for a fistula. And in this case, this was an ethmoidal fistula. And it was fed via both ophthalmic arteries up through the cribriform plate to a central receiving vein. And those aneurysms were actually distal venous varices right around the circle of Willis. And you can see in the late phase, all the veins, which are pretty remote from the side of the fistula, which is right at the anterior cranial fossa cribriform plate. How that could look on an MRI scan with flow voids. And the CT angiogram was somewhat confusing if you were looking at the source images, and it's only after really doing the reconstructions that it started to show what the real pathology was. And there's also supply from the external carotid artery branches as well, just through the STA branches all the way up into the face and the and the eye. So we ended up, for these ethmoidal, this is an ethmoidal dural AV fistula. These are one of those that have traditionally been considered surgical lesions, probably the only dural AV fistula, cranial dural AV fistula that we would consider surgical treatment as maybe a first line offering. Although people are becoming a little bit more aggressive and there are individuals who can do it safely, either transarterially or even transvenous, depending on what the angioarchitecture is of the lesion. For this patient, offered a craniotomy, subfrontal craniotomy, get low in the anterior cranial fossa. And you can see on the CT scans with the CT scans are post-op and the MRI scans are pre-op. You can see the comparable periods that you see there. In the CT angiogram, you see that the veins, those venous varices, the one on the right still fills in the CT angiogram. The later one does not, the one that's out more lateral. This is not my picture of it, but this is pretty much what they all look like. This was taken off of one of Dr. Lawton's videos off of YouTube, but this is a perfect demonstration of the enlarged vein coming up through the cribriform plate and then after ligation. This is the views that you get. So after we had performed the surgery, we were able to successfully ligate the dural AV fistula, no evidence of residual, and also there is the venous varices did not fill anymore, even out into the late arterial phase The follow-up angiograms at 6 months demonstrated continued occlusion of the fistula. So this patient ended up doing very well. I was very happy with her result. So another good case. This was a young man. He presented with pulsatile tinnitus via the ENT referral, and he had this pretty classic looking dural arteriovenous fistula supplied by the ST or by the middle meningeal artery, as well as transmastoid branches at occipital artery. He did have high risk features to this with retrograde cortical venous drainage. And we felt that this is something that we would recommend treatment for. My plan was to go through the middle meningeal artery, but there's a little bit of tortuosity there that's encircled in red. Unfortunately, I was not skilled enough to navigate that despite several different combinations of wires and microcatheters. When I saw that, I thought, yes, this should not be difficult to do, but for one reason or another, I was just ultimately unsuccessful. And I tried to go through the occipital artery. Again, we were able to get pretty close to the fistula site, but we clearly did not get the entire fistula site. And so you can see where the onyx cast is as we occlude those distal branches of the occipital artery. And you can see that on the post-op or the post-embolization external carotid artery branches, those are still filling, the fistula is still filling from the middle meningeal artery. And you can also see the vein, the cortical vein draining forward. In this case, since I was not able to navigate through the middle meningeal artery, and also since I was not able, then you're looking at what other option do you have in a high grade fistula, and you can do surgery. This actually probably would be in pretty straightforward surgery, just to open up right over where your onyx cast is. And actually, since they're radio opaque, it's a great marker for surgery. You just bring in a C-arm into the OR after you position the patient, take a shot, and you can pretty much find out exactly where you need to fashion a little craniotomy to open up and ligate this fistula. But because that was too straightforward, we came up with a different strategy. It's one of those where what's old is new again, because there's been, reports, and people have done this in the past, of basically direct sticks into fistula sites, most famously for vena galen malformations, to just occlude the venous pouch, which was either spectacularly successful or spectacular failures. We do have a hybrid OR with biplane fluoroscopy, that allowed us to attempt something for dural AV fistulas. I actually had done this a number of times for really high-grade dural arteriovenous malformations, which is a different lesion in the substance of the brain, as we all know, where I was not able to get out to a safe point to try to do preoperative embolization. So we had some success with that in a different but somewhat related pathology, and thought, my problem was I could not get past that proximal tortuosity in the middle meningeal artery, but that was a pretty much a straight shot from that to the fistula's point. And if I could just get into that artery and throw a microcatheter in, then I could actually just embolize it from basically right at the fistula site. So we talked with the patient, we knew that this was somewhat novel and also risky, in the sense that if we weren't successful, then we'd have to make a craniotomy a little bit further along and do it the traditional way for ligation. And these cases are much more labor intensive in terms of setup. You have both not only a surgical team, but you also have an interventional team. So our hybrid angio OR suites are fairly sizable. So we had a whole complement both for the surgery, which allows us to do the craniotomy, a very small craniotomy directly over the middle meningeal artery, which we were able to localize using neural navigation, as well as x-rays, kind of identifying where the previous onyx attempts was. And then as soon as we're open, then we can swing the patient over to perform the embolization. This is the patient's setup. He's in a kind of like in a lateral, semilateral position. His head is rotated. You can see we have also, because this is different in the sense that we're not going to be able to really visualize the whole arterial tree from the middle meningeal artery, just out of an abundance of caution, we also obtained femoral access so that we could perform diagnostic angiograms, because the microcatheter angiograms, you could just see the point from the middle meningeal artery on and not the rest of the external or internal carotid circulation. So our angiography table swings over 90 degrees to operate, and then we swing it over 90 and bring the biplane fluoroscopy in to perform the angiograms. So the steps, again, just for the surgery, the intubation, the positioning, and we have to identify exactly where we want to do the procedure. And then once we have the middle meningeal artery exposed after the craniotomy, we need to thread the microcatheter in, which again, that's no small feat. It's not as simple as I imagined in my brain. The catheters are really quite slick. You don't want to use surgical instruments because they could damage the microcatheter. And so you're trying to thread, you know, 1 or 2 millimeter catheter into a 1 millimeter vessel. Once you're in position, you do the angiography, the embolization, and then after surgery, you take everything out and you close up. This is the positioning. That incision that we used is much, much longer than what we needed. We only opened up that portion that you see there in yellow, but we had planned for a much larger flap in case we had to do a bigger craniotomy to surgically ligate the fistula. But make a small little craniotomy, and we identified the middle meningeal artery. As you can see in the lower left, it's a fairly small, I think maybe a silver dollar sized craniotomy. And then we could see the middle meningeal artery's course. We were centered a little bit high. But fortunately, it didn't hurt our procedure. Made a tiny little nick into the middle meningeal artery. I occluded it proximally so it just wouldn't keep bleeding through the opening. Thread that microcatheter through, and I used an entire staple gun of retaining staples to keep it in place because it was fairly tenuous. I have the silk ties there around the opening. But the same thing, if you tie it too tightly, you run the risk of occluding the microcatheter. These are very thin and very small microcatheters. But once in position, you can see exactly where the microcatheter made it all the way to that last bifurcation, and just kind of open it up and soft passed it. Didn't even use a wire, did a microcatheter angiogram, and we were in a pretty ideal position. Proceeded with embolization, and we got a complete cure from that. So even though it was a very large setup, this ended up working very, very well in this specific case. And I think overall, the risk is probably smaller than what it would have been with a more open procedure. We never opened the dura, and the patient did extremely well. So not all cases are navigated like that, or like those first two cases where we ended up doing a pretty good job. This is actually a case I've been struggling with, struggled with this week. This is an older woman. She's 70 years old, but she had pulsatile tinnitus, and she has this very complex dural arteriovenous fistula. There's not a lot of great endovascular options here from a transarterial standpoint. Like she's got all these fine, wispy feeders that have been going through the dura. You can see it's draining. Not only does it drain anterograde down into the internal jugular vein, but it also is draining through labae up into the brain. And so this is definitely a high-risk fistula without any great straightforward transarterial embolization targets. The middle meningeal artery, you know, really we could probably navigate out to, you know, up into this upper area, but that's a long ways for your embolic agents to travel. Occipital artery, all these branches down there are way too wispy. Generally, these are would be microscopic vessels within the dura, but just because of the likely long-standing nature and the significant flow, these have become much more visible. These are not amenable to treatment. I'm sorry, this is the superficial temporal artery, but also it's from the middle meningeal artery there. You can see in the left ICA, and this is why it's important to know the normal anatomy as well, or at least how the brain is using the venous system. But on the venous phase, everything goes out through the right side. So that left transverse sinus and sigmoid sinus is only being used by the fistula, and the normal brain, the brain is using the right side to for venous outflow. And even on the right external carotid artery angiogram, you can see that there's multiple branches of the superficial temporal artery which are forming this complex anastomosis with the fistula on the contralateral side. Since, you know, as I said, there wasn't a great arterial path to the fistula site, you know, you could just take out all those feeders proximally, but you're not going to cure the fistula, and then it's going to continue to recruit from other branches and maintain patency. So I elected to try to go transvenous, and in this case, we would just sacrifice the sinus, and that is also a very tried and true procedure, assuming that the normal brain is not using that sinus system. Here, we have a transradial catheter to do the angiograms. That's the Simmons catheter. We're going through the right radial artery, and then we also have a femoral access for the vein. And normally it's pretty straightforward to get from the superior vena cava up to either jugular veins. In this instance, we really struggled. And you normally just go up blind using fluoroscopy and anatomic landmarks, but because we just could not get over the clavicles, I was able to go up the right jugular vein, but the left jugular vein just could not find a pathway in. And I think this is kind of an example of why these things develop, because venous sinus thrombosis changes the normal architecture of the vein. And in this case, for one reason or other, the jugular venous system on the left side just was not hospitable. And you know, despite multiple attempts and explorations, I just could not get the catheter up into the left jugular vein and into the left jugular bulb to attempt our procedure. Now, like I said, we did get up the right side and thought, well, why don't we just cross, see if we can cross over from the right side, transverse sinus over the torcula to the left side. The reason we didn't try this initially is because, you know, even though I thought maybe there was a small chance we could do it, because you can see right here on the left CCA angiogram where the arrow is, there is a very tight stricture. I didn't hold out a lot of hope that even if I got across the torcula and through all those trabeculations in the left transverse sinus, that I'd be successful getting it through there. After this failed attempt from transvenous, my plan now is to bring her back for direct internal jugular vein access and try and embolize it via that mechanism. And then there are ones, this is a cautionary tale as to what happens if you incompletely treat a fistula, an arteriovenous fistula. This was a 6-year-old boy that I had picked up. He had been followed by some of my predecessors here. Initially, he was born in San Diego. Interesting story, he was born at the Naval Hospital in San Diego. And I'm pretty sure this was a case of where one of my partners, a pediatric neurosurgeon, had shown me his initial films way back when. He was referred out of our system because we weren't quite capable of taking care of something like that, because his date of birth coincided to when I was stationed out in San Diego. But he had undergone multiple treatments. I can't even count, I think at least a dozen at this stage by the time I picked him up. And this is what you would see on the MRI scan, this large dilated vascular structure, which was filled with onyx, which is again, one of our liquid embolic agents, and a bunch of coils. The veins draining through the posterior fossa. You can see a lot of signal change within both the brainstem and the normal brain. And this was a really delightful young boy, but he had progressively become more and more somnolent and wasn't walking, and his vision was deteriorating. And so he presented to the ER because the UVA is where he would get his care. And we repeated the angiogram. This is off of the internal carotid artery, and you can see all those meningeal branches, enlarged Bernasconi catenary through the tent. And it's going to the transverse sinus. But because both transverse sinuses are occluded at this stage, either by the fistula or iatrogenic, the contrast, the flow from the fistula goes in a retrograde fashion up to the superior sagittal sinus and then competes with the rest of the internal carotid artery supply through the brain and into these enlarged veins around the brainstem, the thalamus and brainstem. And again, you can kind of see what that did to his what it did to his brainstem and his posterior fossa. And on the right is the angiographic representation of what that MRI scan looked like. And so question is, where is the fistulous point here? This is just a skull X-ray kind of showing you what this poor boy had been through. Just seeing a lot of that onyx, and the coils are actually barely visible within that onyx cast in multiple surgical clips. He ended up, this is actually an X-ray after one of my surgeries where basically went through the transverse sinus, did a little craniotomy back in the occiput region. And since the transverse sinus was, for all intents and purposes, occluded, I went all the way across from one transverse sinus to the other transverse sinus to cut it off from those meningeal branches that we saw before, which then just left this posterior circulation supply. And again, you can see the supply from the distal vertebral arteries as well as the meningeal branches from the V4 and V3 segments, and everything goes retrograde through this fistulous pouch lateral to that large onyx and coil mass and the superior sagittal sinus, and all the way up again through the cortical veins and in the brain. And once we were able to cut off some of the supply, the anatomy became a little bit more apparent. And I reviewed this case with multiple colleagues of mine, and also my mentor, Cameron McDougall, who trained me. And as we were looking through this and discussing it, it seemed like the common egress site for the fistula was the posterior part of the superior sagittal sinus, right in this area right here, and with this venous pouch. And so the idea was, well, if you could somehow get there to occlude that, maybe that'll make a difference. And this, again, this was our target site. Because I had some success with that direct access embolization, I thought, well, we don't have a normal venous route there, because to get there from the veins, you would have to go through all of that tangled mess in the posterior circulation in the brainstem, and there is no chance that you're going to be able to access that. When I looked through the angiogram, I thought the safest place would be the very anterior, the anterior third of the superior sagittal sinus. That seemed to be the safest place, rather than, he had had multiple surgeries directly overlying this, and I was not confident in my ability to not cause a massive complication, because everything would be scarred down directly over this. So we found a virgin area in the anterior superior sagittal sinus. Again, made a small craniotomy over it. Here's a little video we made of this case. And here, using an ultrasound to identify where we want to be, this standard microneedle insertion technique. This was a very high-tech facilities we have. This is off, I think, one of my fellows' iPhones. But then we advanced the wire. We were able to exchange it for a very small pediatric cardiology sheath. I think it was a 3.4 French. And we navigated this carefully under fluoroscopic visualization down to the superior sagittal sinus. And we were able to then thread a microcatheter all the way back to where the fistula site was, and even into the vein. I hope you guys can see my mouse, but into this vein here. And we proceeded with coil embolization bolstered by Onyx, and the goal was to preserve this cortical vein, these cortical veins were being used both by the fistula as well as the brain. It's just unfortunate the drainage pattern was through his brain. And after that, we cured his fistula. And I had told the mother when I first met him, I said, I'm not sure that this is curable, but we will do what we can. At his basically 2-year follow-up visit, he has basically returned to being his usual vibrant self. He does have deficits from everything he's been through, but his mother states that he's been as good as she's ever seen him. So this was one of those incredibly challenging cases, the most challenging fistula I've ever encountered. And at this stage, I don't even know what type of fistula it was to begin with, since I had met him so late in the course. But that's particularly gratifying. So in conclusion, these are very complex vascular malformations. You really have to think about how you're going to approach it. Some of them are pretty straightforward, but a lot of times, since there are a multitude of options that you can use, it really takes a true partnership with the patient to come up with the best plan for them. You know, with benign dural AV fistulas, they can be treated expectantly, and most of the time I encourage that with patients, but every once in a while it just becomes too much of a effect on the quality of life, and they do request treatment. Aggressive high-grade dural AV fistulas, those should absolutely be treated, unless there's some very significant medical issues. And these complex lesions, I always counsel the patients, I'm not sure I'm going to be able to do it. It may take more than one time, one try. It might be a multi-stage endovascular procedure. If we're not ultimately successful, we might have to do surgery or radiosurgery or some combination of both. But thank you very much for your time. And I think we have a little bit of time for questions.
Dr. Park, that was really, really wonderful. Very much appreciate your time today. And as Jian mentioned, we both are so happy for all the mentoring that you've done. And you actually sparked a big interest of mine in cerebrovascular surgery, which wasn't an original intent. By, as everybody saw today, your ability to make these incredibly complicated cases seem somewhat manageable to comprehend for low-level thinkers such as myself. So thank you for that. That case with the 6-year-old was incredible, and it just reminds me of some of the toughest cases we had during training that I try to help you with. To that end, we have some interesting questions here from the audience, so I'll go into them. Dr. Briganti asked, in the war theater, were there many fistulas resulting from war injuries? Also, in the process of assessing the war injuries, were there any unknown fistulas identified, or was the timing too short during your follow-up?
So I was fortunate enough, the military neurosurgery community is pretty small, especially those of us who had an interest and passion in vascular. So I knew where they were going. When they were in theater, we kept them. If they were coalition or US troops, they were after any significant injury, they were medevaced within 24 hours, oftentimes at the latest 48 hours. So we never really had time to do any of that initial workup. And since the traumas, you know, with these fistulas, they can be in a delayed fashion. I did talk with some of the neurosurgeons like Dr. Armando, who was at Walter Reed at the time. Yes, on the delayed workup, they would absolutely find delayed presentations of vascular lesions, like traumatic pseudoaneurysms are ones that they would see initially. I mean, we had a CT and CT angio capabilities. I did not see any real, we had a fair number of penetrating injuries. And we really didn't identify many traumatic pseudoaneurysms at the time, but then downrange, again, because they're getting just that initial CT angiogram, granted there was a lot of metallic artifact as well, oftentimes. And so when they return stateside, they'll get a formal diagnostic angiogram, and a number of different vascular pathologies would be identified in that acute period, mostly traumatic pseudoaneurysms. I don't have that follow-up for later on when you might see fistulas develop.
Great. Dr. Lopez asks, can you define, you might have already gone through this a little bit, but define the aggressive dural arteriovenous fistula?
So, you know, with both the Borden and the Conard classifications, it's really looking to see where they're draining. If they're using the venous sinuses, then they're benign. If they're only using the venous sinuses, as soon as a cortical vein is involved with the drainage pattern of a fistula, that's where it tips it over to the aggressive side. So in actuality, you know, again, because we don't really parse out the data as well as see if there's a difference between a Conard 5 and a Conard 3, In actuality, it's pretty binary. It's either benign course, where everything drains either antegrade or retrograde, but stays within the venous sinus, or as soon as a cortical vein is recruited to assist with venous outflow of the fistula, then it tips it over into the aggressive side.
Wonderful. The emergency room is watching you today, and they just wanted to say no question, just admiration and kudos from the ER. So thank you for that. Dr. Mehta was asking, what symptoms and signs in someone with a persistent post-traumatic or post-concussion headaches would raise the suspicion for you to investigate further for either a subdural hematoma or an AV fistula?
That's always the question. Is like, we don't want to overuse our resources, but if somebody is having persistent headaches or especially worsening headaches, then I think non-invasive imaging is very reasonable. What you can see in a CT scan, a lot of people, you can get a CT scan a lot sooner. It's a lot quicker. Patients generally prefer it over an MRI scan. And that would be helpful if there's any concern of a subdural hematoma developing in a delayed fashion, like a subacute or chronic subdural hematoma, but you're not really going to see the substance of the brain itself. An MRI scan will, even though it's not perfect for fistulas, does, I believe, have a higher chance of picking something up than a CT scan, unless you're doing a CT scan with angio. But there isn't any real set criteria that I use to say, what's my threshold? I think it really is figuring out how miserable the patient is, because again, these can, post-concussive headaches are fairly common. Any of us who see head trauma patients on a routine basis, we're a level one trauma center. So we get that and we see them in follow-up. Most of the time I won't do anything extra, but if the headaches are persistent, then I think it might be worthwhile to get like a one-time, you know, MRI scan to see if there's anything. And the only way you're going to pick up a fistula in that sense is, in that instance, is if there's any significant flow voids. But the pulsatile tinnitus is probably one of the most common symptoms that people with fistulas will have.
And so when you're following these patients, Dr. Laborde asks, for patients with conservative or undergoing conservative treatment, how do you schedule or what's their timeline for follow-up of images?
I don't really have one. I really do leave it to the patient. By and large, benign fistulas don't morph into aggressive fistulas. Mm-hmm. And that's the teaching and the prevalent thought that we have. If there is a change in the character of the sound, all of a sudden they say, you know, it's gotten progressively worse or it somehow shifted, it might be worthwhile to, those are the times when I tell patients to, you know, reach out to us again, and we'll maybe reevaluate that. But if you were going to reevaluate a benign fistula just for routine sake, I would probably extend it out a number of years. You know, with my aneurysm patients, I'll extend out, you know, interval scans for 5 years. So I'm used to telling patients that, look, we're going to put it in our computer system. It's going to ding, you know, in 2027. Mm-hmm. We'll call you to remind you to get it. But if something changes in the meanwhile, you know, let us know. And most of the time with the benign variants, I have the patients just say, reach out if something changes or if it's starting to affect your quality of life.
And the same thing goes for spinal fistulas. I know we're talking about a little bit of a different presentation.
I think spinal fistulas pretty much are, we believe they're all high risk. There's not really a benign spinal dural AV fistula. It might be benign because it hasn't caused venous congestion and signs of myelopathy. But if you see one incidentally, you'll see a lot of times they'll be on flow voids on the MRI scans, on the T2 sequences. But you know, it's one of those, they're very rare. And more often than not, they're in older patients who also have degenerative disease. And the average time to diagnosis for a spinal dural AV fistula is about a year, you know, from symptom onset. So it is something that we don't do a great job of identifying right away. But if you have one, it needs treatment.
Wonderful, wonderful. I believe those are the major questions here. Dr. Park, again, thank you very much. Gian and I, and the rest of Little Company of Mary and Providence, Southern California, are honored and really appreciate you taking the time to meet with us today.
Oh, it's absolutely my pleasure. And it's always great to see, you know, two wonderful neurosurgeons that I had a small role in working with succeed as well as you guys have done. And again, my wife is quite jealous that you guys are where you are and that we are where we are.
There's always a spot for you.
Dr. Park, we're paying $6 a gallon of gas here.
I thought Wally would just use those electric scooters around Santa Monica.
Fair point.
Thank you, Dr. Park. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Dr. Park.
And we do want you coming back to give that war injury, the naval head injury talk at some point here when you have time.
Oh, absolutely! I'd be happy to. It'd be wonderful to get back out there.
Yeah. Okay. Take care. Thank you all. And again, please make sure you sign your name for CME credit. And if for future talks or requests, please go ahead and reach out to us. And everybody have a happy and safe week.
Thanks, everyone.